Hello, and welcome to my first video on macroeconomics and financial markets. The reason why I'm producing this video is because I think a lot of information on economics currently on YouTube is really geared toward Western economies. And I think that whenever a Nigerian sort of official, whether it's a Minister for Finance, but especially the CBN governor comes out with new economic policy, there's, you know, a really huge debate on social media and in social environments about whether it's right or wrong. And sometimes some of those debates are kind of built on really faulty economic assumptions. So if you really want to be able to contribute meaningfully to the debate around economic policy in Nigeria, which is a really serious thing, right? We have more people in Nigeria living in poverty than anywhere in the world. We're the poverty capital of the world. We've got slow economic growth. We've got our population rate growing faster than our economic growth rate. We have a high level of debt compared to our revenue. So it's really important for as many people as possible to know the fundamentals. So what I'm going to do in, I hope, around 30 minutes is take you through a whistle-stop tour of the main principles in macroeconomics. By the time you finish, you would have an overview of almost every main principle of macroeconomics, and we'll be able to have more informed conversations about our joint future. Enjoy. So I've spoken about the CBN governor before and the policies in Nigeria and some of the more interesting and unorthodox things I'll be touching on that he has been able to develop and deploy over his tenure. So I'm going to be talking about macroeconomics and the world of finance as a basic introduction. I'll be talking about savings and finance. I'll be talking about fiscal policy, monetary policy, investments, international capital flows and foreign exchange, and of course, expectation, inflation and interest rates. So in the first unit, I'll be putting macroeconomics into context and talking about the difference between long run and short run economics, the national income account, which is a subject of a lot of debate, and then aggregate demand and supply. So what is macroeconomics? Macroeconomics is the study of the economy as a whole. And the backdrop of that is the national indicators that companies and countries use to make decisions. So there's a few challenges with macroeconomic information, which I'd like you to be aware of. Number one is that economists sometimes use different definitions of different things. So the unemployment rate, for instance, in Nigeria, and our definition is different from what some of the other countries use. And also because literally the information comes out every quarter, sometimes there's mistakes. It has to come out in a really short time frame. So sometimes you find that countries have to revise their figures after they've already brought them out. Another concept that I'd like us to get to grips with is short run and long run economics. So long run economics is focused on the average amount of growth over a specific period of time. So obviously economies go up and down, there's boom and bust cycles. So, you know, it's the average over a longer period of time, whereas the short run economics is what's happening right now currently. So, and this is important because policies that induce faster growth in the medium term might actually be counterproductive for the long term. So it's important to think about the current crisis or the current issues, but also have a long-term perspective. Aggregate demand and supply is like a big concept in economics, and aggregate demand is basically the sum total of all demand in an economy, from consumption plus government spending plus net exports plus investments. Aggregate supply is the total supply to economy to meet that demand. And there's two types. There's the short run aggregate supply and the long run aggregate supply. And I'll be talking about those later on in the video. So aggregate demand. Aggregate demand has a graph, and if you're studying economics or you're taking any economics exams, then this is a graph that you kind of need to know, one of the most important graphs, I would say. and it's a downward sloping graph, and it compares the general price level to the rate of GDP, and GDP is always equal to aggregate demand. So the formula how to calculate GDP, which we'll be talking about later, is the same as aggregate demand. So a rise in any of the factors of either consumption, investment, government spending, or net exports will shift the aggregate demand curve to the right. And if any of them reduce, then it will shift it to the left. And there'll be coinciding changes in the general price level as well. And these are just some of the causes of aggregate demand shocks. What could change the level of aggregate demand? And basically, when you're thinking about things that change the level of aggregate demand, you're thinking about things that change any of the components of aggregate demand. So anything that changes consumption, investment, government spending, or net exports. And things like a recession, things like a rise or fall of the interest rate, a thing like a global credit crunch where companies can't access credits, etc. Those will shift the demand aggregate. So these are some of the things that can cause a fall in aggregate demand, an increase in aggregate demand. And as you can see, it's quite intuitive because they're the things that affect the factors that add up to aggregate demand. When we talk about aggregate supply measures the volume of goods and services produced every year. And aggregate supply represents the ability of an economy to deliver goods and services to meet demand. There's two graphs to remember for aggregate supply. During the short run, sellers of goods are receiving higher prices for their products without a proportionate increase in the cost of what they're using to produce those products or their inputs. So the higher the price level, the more these sellers will be willing to supply. So you get the curved graph. However, in the long run, things kind of balance out, right? And we have a straight long run aggregate supply curve in the long run, because in the short run, of course, there's a lag between the potential output of an economy and the price level, but that levels out in the long run. Now we're on to the sort of meat of this unit, which is the national income accounts. And you know, we obsess over the national income account in Nigeria. The national income account are all those fundamental aggregate statistics that we use to measure the economy. And you know, this was sort of such a breakthrough in economics because centuries ago we weren't measuring these factors, and people wondered why there were periods in time where people got poorer, where there was a lot of poverty, where there were riots. So this was a huge breakthrough when countries around the world decided to start measuring the national income accounts. So the most important, the one that you hear all the time, the one that we debate about, the one that we obsess about, is GDP. And GDP is the total monetary or market value of all finished goods and services produced within a country's borders over a particular time frame. So it's basically like, you know, how much a country makes. And national income is actually measured in three ways. We can measure the income, we can measure the output, or we can measure the expenditure. And just as a note on GDP, GDP is used as an indicator of a country's economic strength. GNI, however, shows the total income received by a country, and that's used to indicate the economic strength of the residents of that country. So I'm going to talk about, for the last bit of this unit, I'm going to talk about the effects of inflation and how we counter the effects of inflation on GDP. And inflation is basically the rise in price level that happens over time. So I'm sure you hear your parents or like really old people saying that, oh, when I was your age, I only earned like 500 naira a year or something really, you know, dramatic like that. You hear them saying stuff like, oh, you know, I used to fly from Lagos to London for 5 naira. And you know, the price level of the naira, the Nigerian currency, has definitely risen over time. And we have to, when we're studying economics, these are some of the things that we take into consideration. Inflation, high levels of inflation are destructive, right? They're destructive to people's savings. I think that they call inflation like the silent robber. So we try and keep our levels of inflation under control. We try and monitor our levels of inflation, analyze our levels of inflation. And we've actually developed GDP measures and all kinds of sort of mitigating measures to make sure that whenever we're looking at an economy, especially like Nigeria, where we have relatively high levels of inflation, we're actually taking that into consideration. So the first major consideration is the real versus nominal GDP. The nominal GDP is the market value of goods and services produced in an economy that is not adjusted for inflation. The real GDP, the one that we feel on the streets, is the GDP adjusted for inflation, and that reflects real output. Some other things that we use that I'll be discussing in the slides are things like the GDP deflator and the consumer price index. So the GDP deflator, to calculate that, we put nominal GDP over real GDP. So the GDP deflator measures how much real GDP differs from nominal GDP. We also have the consumer price index, which looks at the current price of a basket of goods over the base price of a basket of goods. And what I mean by the base price is what it was in the year that we've chosen to compare it to. So obviously, if you know, we had a basket of goods like when our parents were in school that cost, I don't know, they cite all these dramatic figures, don't they, like 1 naira, and now, you know, a basket of goods, tomatoes, rice, cassava, whatever you put in that basket, is now like 10 times the price. Of course, the consumer price index will be high. So we measure that against the base year. We choose a base year where we want to compare all of the baskets of goods to that year, and then we see how the price has risen and get a ratio, a number that reflects how the prices have risen in the current year compared to. And then there's something called substitution bias that I just want to touch on, because we definitely have that in Nigeria. And this is describes a possible bias in economic index numbers if they don't incorporate data on consumer expenditures switching from relatively more expensive products to cheaper products as the prices changed. So I think especially in Nigeria, we need to consider substitution bias when we're looking at inflation and when we're looking at the cost of goods and what people are actually buying, because we find that when rice is expensive, Nigerians just switch to cassava. When cassava is expensive, they switch to something else, amala, or whatever is cheap. And that causes a problem in economic calculations if you're not calculating for the fact that they've substituted. People have substituted one more expensive good for another one. So another method that we use to calculate inflation is chain weighting, and chain weighting takes into account changes in the price and in spending patterns. So this helps us guard against substitution bias in the market, because we take into consideration the fact that people have changed for whatever reason from a more expensive, relatively expensive good. Now, some of the drawbacks of GDP. So, like I said at the beginning, we really obsess over GDP. We talk about GDP, we think about GDP. Everything in the economy leads back to GDP, and it is a good measure of the wealth of your economy. However, one of my favorite quotes about GDP comes from David Pilling, and he says, from a GDP perspective, nuclear warheads do just as well as hospital beds or apple pie. So the thing about GDP is it's just measuring output, right? It's not measuring what that output is. So of course, a country could be producing hundreds of nuclear warheads and it would still count into GDP. But they might not have any hospitals, but nobody cares because GDP is actually just a measure of production of anything. It doesn't matter what you are producing. So it's not the greatest measure of well-being. And I'll be talking about this on this slide. It doesn't really measure income distribution. It doesn't measure, you know, mothers, for instance, for the work of full-time mothers that work in the household, cooking, cleaning, looking after children. And it doesn't take externalities, how people spend their leisure time, how disruptive production activities have been to the environment. It doesn't measure social well-being. And even though there's a strong correlation between GDP and standard of living, it's not a measure of standard of living.